Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Mason Dambrot. Critical Thought TV has two roles. We look at consilience, the quest for a unified theory of human knowledge, and futurism, where we take what we know, we take scientific discoveries, and run them out into the future and see where that leads us. We're honored to have today as our guest, Jason Silva. Opening up synthetic biology a bit.
Yes.
If we were to say, look at a wide range of the areas that fall under synthetic biology,
sure.
All the way from synthetic genomics,
right.
Through molecular modeling used to create artificial biomolecular structures,
uh-huh, uh-huh.
Going all the way through the interface of biology and electronics,
right.
Neurons on a chip. Learning to communicate in on their own with the electronic component, using slime molds or DNA structures as a computational architecture, all the way out to Craig Venter and literally creating artificial life. Well, the first time
right.
he did it, it was kind of a hack, but the second time was the real deal.
Yeah.
So given that, how, in your view, will synthetic biology help, hinder, accelerate, decelerate our move towards our transhumanist future?
Yeah, well, I think we might start off by saying, why even call it artificial life? I mean, at the end of the day, it's life creating life. And if you look at, you know, Buckminster Fuller said, start with the universe. You look at Earth as a planetary system that sprouts life in an organic fashion, then the microchip is just as natural as a flower blooming. And, you know, a scientist creating artificial life in a lab is no different than, like, you know, an animal having sex with another animal or an animal having sex with another of the same species and you know, reproducing natural selection. It's still life creating life. So the whole notion of calling it artificial or non-human or unnatural is silly. It's all natural. The other aspect that excites me about synthetic life is this idea that the canvas for human creativity, okay, is now life itself. I mean, when you consider technology as an instrument of mind expansion, look at like a scaffolding that extends our thought, reach, and vision. The technology of the microscope, the technology of the telescope, both make us privy of realities that we're ordinarily unaware of, right? They let us see that there's always so much more that we do not perceive. They extend us. Imagine how impoverished humanity would have been if we hadn't invented the technology of the instrument before Beethoven or Mozart came along. Or imagine if we hadn't invented the technology of oil painting and time for Van Gogh to flourish through it. So this idea that now synthetic biology says life itself is the canvas, the new palette that the artist, that human creativity can be funneled through. What might we create? I mean, we who are part of the human species, which is a remarkable species, still kind of emerged not by design, but by natural selection. But imagine now if sentience, if intelligent design can now actually be applied to the canvas of life. So to all those, you know, creationists out there, one might say this is intelligent design at last that we're talking about.
Right.
And that's what synthetic biology, I think, excites. That's why it excites me.
Me too. And that would be intelligent design accomplished by Homo sapiens.
Right.
Not by some transcendental entity.
Totally. And, you know, if you extrapolate a future where our minds become decentralized and substrate independent, in a way we take on the godlike qualities that people sort of are hopeful for and who are religiously inclined. So rather than this notion of God having created the universe, it's more like this universe sprouted Homo sapiens will eventually sprout technology that makes them substrate independent. So it's low organization, low order matter creating complex entities like humans, which will then create entities that are not dependent on certain types of matter to exist. Mm-hmm.
So and that argument
it reverses the thing. Yeah.
The argument could be extended to say two things.
Yeah.
One would be that, in fact, the self-organizing principle of biological matter created creatures that needed to interpret their sensorium and so invented metaphysics and religion to offer an explanation to reduce their anxiety over being aware of their mortality.
Right.
Right? So all of that changes, you know, over the next few decades. But pushing it out even a little bit more, perhaps I could ask you this. Given that matter self-organizes, becomes biological, turns into us, and everything we see, as you've said in some of your great documentaries, is us. It starts with the concept and moves through instantiation, and it's out there.
Right.
And we are witnessing the, as you mentioned earlier, the decrease in lag time between the idea and the actuality. So if we create artificial life, synthetic life, and that synthetic life is intelligent and has intention, so then that would, what I want to ask is, wouldn't that create the possibility of that synthetic life at a certain future level of complexity having its own intentions and its own ability to actualize?
Oh, absolutely.
And what would that look like? What could that look like?
Well,
it's hard to imagine.
It's as hard to imagine as a rich symbolic inner world of metaphysical representational capacities would be conceivable to Homo sapien prior to the invention of language. So that's how inconceivable what this synthetic life might ultimately express itself as is to us. We lack the neural architecture at the moment. We can conceive of one way that we might want to design it, but the moment that that artificial life, which again is not artificial because it's just life creating life, but the moment in which this new form of intelligence emerges and it itself starts to design its own evolution, at that point it's difficult for us to extrapolate what that might look like. Although we keep calling it and them and this other life, that's really going to be us.
Right. That whole notion of false objectification is really rampant because we have the illusion that we're isolates moving around in an empty space.
Right.
When in fact it's eco niches are systems.
Right.
You can't separate the animal from the eco niche from the relationship between the two and all of that.
Which is why I tell people, just because the iPhone is not physically tethered to me, just because the BlackBerry is not within my tissue, doesn't mean that it's not a part of me. It's outsourced cognition. It stores extra memory for me. It helps me mediate with the world. It allows me to have telepathic functions when I send SMS messages. I mean, the Vitruvian man today, as I've said, frontal lobe, neocortex, and in his hand, an iPhone. And the diagram would point to the iPhone as if it was a part of his anatomy, even though it's not physically tethered to him. We need to get over the skin bag bias. Minds operate in a baffling dance between brains, their environments, and their tools. Andy Clark, Natural Born Cyborgs, said that.
So, you know, to finish up this this one question, it gives an entirely new layer of beauty and meaning to the well-known phrase that the universe is not only stranger than we imagine, it's stranger than we can imagine.
And that is, I would call that a beautiful ending to this segment. Well said.